Jai Bhim friends, welcome to the Ambedkar Age series of videos. In this series, Roundtable India aims to produce documentaries, talks, interviews and discussions on contemporary issues from a Dalit Bahujan perspective. In this latest episode, we talked to Dr. Manisha Bangar, Vice President of BAMSAF. So, BAMSAF and Bahujan and Mool Niwasi, how would you explain these concepts and these ideas?
BAMSAF is an organization. It's a backward and converted minority employees federation. Yeah. So backward, we have the scheduled caste, yes, the scheduled tribes, the OBC.
Okay.
They're all backward as defined by the constitution. So okay, as Baba Saab said, socially and educationally backward classes.
Okay.
These are the ones.
Okay.
And then we have out of these SC, ST, OBCs, who have converted themselves in different point in history into various other religions, whether they're Buddhist or Christians or Sikhs or Muslims,
yeah,
they are the converted minorities.
Yeah.
So it's the Employees Federation of these people,
yeah,
and it's a national level organization with many wings, and it also has an international wing. It's been in the field and working for almost 40 years now, ever since it was formed in 1978,
yeah,
by Kanshiramji, Khapade Saab and two more people, Kamleji. It goes with the goal of a social transformation. So it kind of hinges its vision on what Dr. Ambedkar said in his Agra speech in 1956, that the educated classes are the ones who should lead the movement.
Yeah.
They should be the leaders of the movement. That is one thing. Another thing is that Dr. Ambedkar also said that these people have to, the whole educated class has to transform itself into an intellectual class to bring about the vision that this is a political democracy. India is a political democracy.
Yeah.
But the social democracy and economical democracy is yet to be achieved.
Yeah.
So, how to utilize the half-baked democracy that we are having,
yeah,
so as to get the social democracy? That is the vision of BAMSAF.
Okay.
It goes with that. So in Hindi we say it, Samajik Parivartan,
yeah,
or Samajik Kranti.
Yes.
So that is the vision of BAMSAF. Now Bahujan. Bahujan is a nomenclature. It's a word.
Yeah.
It's a word which though has been popularized in the recent times because we have modern means of propagation now.
Yeah.
But it is a word which has been used by Buddha himself.
Okay.
It's not a BAMSAF creation,
yeah,
but it is also it indicates only the numerology or numericals.
Mm.
So it doesn't, it only tells us that yes, in this country there are people who are in the majority, means that there are people in the minority also.
Yeah.
And why does it become important? Not only because Buddha defined it, it becomes important because as we are conversing, we have begun our discussion and we all understand that it is the Bahujans who are languishing in this modern state now.
Yeah.
Numerically. So the majority are the ones who are disinvested, dispossessed of their educational, their political, their economic rights and their human dignity. And therefore it becomes something which is very, very important.
So it becomes political.
It becomes social as well as political. So cultural also, why not?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, because Bahujan Hitaya, Bahujan Sukhaya, when Buddha at his times saw that the Bahujans are the ones who are suffering, they are the tolling masses, that is the reason why he had to say Bahujan Hitaya, Bahujan Sukhaya. If the Bahujans were already happy, then there was no sense in saying that. So he gives a context and we have developed on that context. Many people usually feel that it pertains only to the OBCs. No, it's not that. OBCs form a part of the Bahujans.
Yeah.
It equally includes the scheduled castes. It includes the scheduled tribes. It includes the minorities also.
Yes.
Because they have been the suppressors of the same system which has subjugated the OBCs. The manifestations of the subjugation has been different. The impact of the subjugation or the signs, the ways in which the masses are subjugated is different. So, for scheduled caste, the subjugation of the severest kind has been through untouchability. For the OBCs, it has been through lack of a total disqualifying them from education. For the minorities, it has been totally not giving them their citizen rights also. So it has been different. But it essentially has been that the minority people who have been the governing class, who are the cultural Brahmin class or the upper caste or Varna, so everything comes into perspective. From where does this minority and majority concept come in the modern times?
Yeah.
It actually comes again when Dr. Ambedkar is giving a interview to the BBC journalist.
Yeah.
That was, I guess, in 1952 or so. So this is a time when we have an independent India, independent of Britishers, but not of the traditional rulers, the
yes.
Brahmins and the upper caste. So you have that India, and Dr. Ambedkar is interviewed by a British BBC journalist. And then he says that, Dr. Ambedkar, you have the independence now, and then you have a political democracy which is functioning, you have elections. So what exactly is your problem and why are you not so happy about the whole scheme of things? Journalist also asks him that what do you think is the main problem that the country is facing now? What is the main problem that your movement is facing, you as ex-intangibles? So he says that the problem is not so much as to the end, but the problem is to the beginning. So what is the beginning? He says that the beginning is that I really do not know how to get this heterogeneous people to come together, to form an associate force of living and be associated beings who can go through the common, towards the common goal. And he also says that it's the problem of my country and the problem that we are facing is that a microscopic minority, a determined and a conscious microscopic minority, he says, is creating conditions in its favor to keep the majority in a heterogeneous, fragmented, amorphous state. That is the problem, he says. And therefore, this minority and majority. So the rule of the minority over the majority, in which the majority is broken into pieces, hindering their unification so as to form a strong force and achieve its goal. So that is how everything can be placed.
Bahujan. The Brahmin as an invader is a ever-present theme across regions. Baba Sahib also said a clearly defined class with, you know, internal political and social philosophies. Contradiction, Baba Sahib also posted this view that, you know, all of history of India is the history of mortal struggle between Buddhism and Brahmanism. He has posited the mostly the Dalits and other Bahujans as Buddhists, and you know, the upper caste or the Brahmin led upper caste as Brahmin belonging to Brahmin.
Yes, yes,
and
yes.
There is also concept of the Shramanic religion, which are closer to the Buddhist religion.
Yes, yes,
the
yes.
Shramanic religions are still the village deities religions or some other religions, which I understand, as I understand it. But I don't see any problem with the Moolivasi concept, except that people need to know more about that concept.
There have to be certain criteria for what identity that you want to get along with.
Yeah.
One, it should be the identity which is given by yourself to yourself. Your own
yes.
people have to, you know, you have to say, yeah, this is something I want to call myself, my community, my society. Then secondly, it has to be, if Baba Sahib's main problem was the vivisection of the society, and it still remains so, we are grappling with the caste system.
Yeah.
That remains so. The second thing about the identity has to be that it has to be a unifying identity.
Yeah.
Thirdly, it has to be a majoritizing identity. See how it is linking with your politics. It has to be an identity which will also talk about your culture, your lineage, your legacy, your value system, your ethics, your politics. What has happened for Brahmana, the Brahmin? It talk, Brahmana, when you say Brahma, Vedanta, comes along with the class, comes with Sanskrit, comes with the Eurasia,
yes.
comes with the
it's
you know,
whole set of
it's
beliefs.
A whole world, it's a
yeah.
Brahminical world. In that, Brahmin identity is there. Which is our world? Where is our world? Have we not been living?
Yes.
Have we been living in the Brahminical world? No, we were never a part of the Brahminical world.
So this is an attempt to...
Resurrect, reconstruct. Okay. As much as we are deconstructing the Brahminical world and deconstructing the Brahminical world for our people who has thought that it is their world.
Yeah.
Our people feel that that world is their world. No. Yeah. So we want to resurrect, reconstruct, excavate and see what is ours. History has always been written by the people who were in the ruling.
Yes.
They were the dominant class. They were the dominant people, each and every. So they wrote the history in their favor. We have to write the history and our legacy, and quite a bit of it is there already.
Okay.
Then you're talking about the Buddhist and the Brahminical struggle, as Dr. Ambedkar you said. Well, Mulivasi, this concept, Mulivasi means root.
Yep.
Rooted in, I do not want to give the testimony or the legitimacy through Brahminical text, but even in the Buddhistic, even in the Brahminical text and many more literature which has followed, they say it has been clearly written that Brahmins have destroyed. How did they come and rule upon us? So they say, they have said it, that they destroyed the mool.
Okay.
The mool means the root. Okay, the original. So what was the original? You go to Guru Nanak Dev Ji's, the Guru Granth Sahib.
Okay.
There are so many references to the mool.
Yeah.
And he says about, talks of the mool. You have, when you talk about the mool nivasi, we are not only, it's not only a term, a racial term, or definitely it is not a racial term. It is a geographical, cultural terminology. What is the main contention is that Baba Sahib has not said. That is what people say.
Okay. Not in clear terms.
Okay. Now it's very interesting. If at all you go into the depth of it, who were the Shudras is the place where Dr. Ambedkar very clear cut. Forget about revolution and counter revolution.
Yeah.
Forget about the other text where he clearly, so many references, we are lacking time, otherwise I could provide you with them. And anybody can ask from the organization side and we can provide page by page, word by word, documentary evidences that Dr. Ambedkar has followed his guru, Mahatma Phule, in this particular trend that the Aryans have invaded India.
Yeah, he did say the Aryans did come in, but
invaded, not migration, not invitation, but invasion.
Okay.
Invasion, clear-cut invasion. And I do not want to quote one or two studies which are the genetic studies or DNA-based studies. Least anybody would say that, okay, you know, the madam is trying to give a racial connotation to it. No, not that. Who were the Shudras? He says that, and he has shown with evidences, that there were only two Varnas, or three Varnas. Three Varnas, Rigveda.
Two Varnas actually, and then third Varna came around the Gupta period.
First thing is, Dr. Ambedkar has been very clear on three things. One is that the Rigveda, it did not have Shudra Varna. Okay, it had three Varnas. That the Rigveda has not been written in India, it has been written over there, in Eurasia, Iranian subcontinent. He is very clear. Thirdly, he says that this concept of the Brahmana Sutra, that the Brahmana arises from the head and all those, Purusha Sukta, that has been a later insinuation after the Aryans came over here.
Yes.
There is no confusion on the point that there were earlier three Varnas. The three Varnas were the Brahmin, Kshatriya and Vaishya. The long struggle between the Brahmin and the Kshatriya led to the formation of the fourth Varna, that is the Shudras. Now this Shudra is the Aryan Brahmin, Aryan Kshatriya, Aryan Vaishya and Aryan Shudra. They are the Aryan four Varnas which were formed before the Aryans came into India. And these were minuscule, very few in number. They were the minority. Then when they came over here, whatever the Kshatriyas, they fought with them, they challenged the Brahmins, and that is why they were punished and formed into the fourth Varna. Dr. Ambedkar says that even when the Shudras over here or the Mulivasis over here, they had not fought with the Brahmins, still
they
were classified as Shudras. So you have, what do you have then? You have Aryan Brahmins, Aryan Kshatriyas, means Aryan means in Eurasia, and Aryan Shudras and Aryan Vaishyas, and you have indigenous Shudras. You have indigenous. So there are two kinds of Shudras, Aryan Shudras and indigenous Shudras. Aryan Shudras have been minuscule in number, and the Brahmins have been cunning enough to apply the same punishment for no fault of these, only because they were indigenous and they wanted them to follow their Vedic way of life, and the entire punishment and banishment was forced on these indigenous people, turning the whole mass of people into Shudras. And then at the time of Buddha, when we have this indigenous mass of people, the Shudras, which were there as the fourth Varna.
Please tell us about your environment at home, college, and later, which evolved into this, you know, kind of politics.
My Masaji, that is my mother's elder sister's husband, he was a lawyer in Bhandara, and his library was full of books of Dr. Ambedkar, on books on Buddhism. And then I found myself going through Baba Saab's books much earlier, when I was in the 7th standard, 8th standard. I would just go through it, not that I understood, but I remember that I did understand quite a bit of Buddha and his Dhamma, because it was in such a lucid language. I was from St. Joseph's Convent. I was a convent educated student, and I could decipher all that. Second influence was my nani, that is my mother's mother, who during her time had also taken up to Buddhism, because they had converted themselves when Dr. Ambedkar gave his conversion ceremony in 1956. My nana and nani both had gone. That scientific way of looking at things, you know, non-Brahminical evaluation, and so all those things, they came to me from her. And of course, my father and my father's side also, because they were also again labor leaders, they were corporators, and they were socially very much committed people, always working for the community and society, and a lot of thrust on education, a lot of thrust on scientific orientation towards life, and everything that was non-Brahminical. And our area where I was born was essentially a scheduled caste community, mill workers, mill owners, you know, lower middle class income people. But we had an educated background, so we were slightly in the middle class income group. Yeah, my mother was also a PhD. She has been, she is a PhD. So all this was a very educated environment. Also, which is very, very phenomenal, I would say, and I would like to rather link myself to it, not in a very hereditical manner, but a value-based connection or a value-based legacy that one receives through the environment. Sulochanathai Dongre, she is my real maternal uncle's wife, you know, and my grandfather, maternal grandfather, Nana Sahib Dongre, my mama, maternal uncle, Shripad Dongre, both of them, you know, pushed her, and she also turned out to be a very phenomenal activist traveling across India
in
50s, later 50s, sorry, not later, later 40s, okay, and early 50s.
Okay.
In fact, this conference was in 1942, so that makes it later 30s.
This was the For India Scheduled Caste
Federation in 1942 in Nagpur, okay, where almost 25,000 women were organized, and they attended the conference. She organized, and she was the president of the conference.
Oh.
And she was with Baba Sahab, and she was one of the foremost workers. And so I came to know much later on. I had heard her name during my childhood years. But then when I went to college and all, then I heard her name, I read her work, and then all the family stories, and so that was a big inspiration. I remember I was in Delhi doing my super specialization in gastroenterology. Basically, I'm a liver transplant specialist. Yeah, and I'm a super specialist doctor, medical doctor, gastroenterologist. So during my training in Delhi, That is the time when I came across people and cadres who were working for Bansal.
This was in
1996-97.
Okay. 20 years ago.
Yeah, 20 years ago. So I came across them, and soon I was, and I would in fact like to take the names of the people. One is Shrikant Lokhande and Ashish Jeevne. So through them, I was, they took me to the organization office in Karol Bagh. And I became, then I was soon, Khapade Sahab, one of the founder members of the organization, he spotted me and he saw, and I was speaking. And then soon I was doing a lot of cater work in Delhi itself. As soon as my exams got over, thankfully my husband, Ravindra Bangar, he was also a person who was socially oriented, and we kind of both started doing work for Bamsef. Whether I was posted in Bombay, I was in JJM for some time, and then I was assistant professor in gastroenterology in Nair. Then also I remember most of my afternoons used to go and meeting people, going and telling them about Bamsef, conducting meetings, conventions. And then that is how, you know, I became more involved.
How do you manage this to both, it's usually that women are supposed to enter into women kind of rights kind of movement, but you have taken on a much more larger social platform.
Bamsef gave me that vision, actually, you know. We had by that time developed our own pedagogy, you know, Bamsef, and through the readings of Jyoti Rao and every. So feminism as such, I was never much attracted towards the feminism for two reasons. One is not only I found it very, a lot of aversion in the sense that it was totally taken up by upper caste Brahmin women who gave a totally different turn to what actually women rights are. And then when I kind of compared and contrasted it with what Dr. Ambedkar said, what Savitri Bai Phule, their life and struggles, you know, actual living, and how they positioned their enemies. So the feminist movement positions its enemy in the man, okay, or the masculinity, or the patriarchy, okay, and then they stop at it. They just stop themselves over there. Mulivasi Bahujanwad, Ambedkarwad, Phulewad, this, everything. My legacy allows me to go beyond patriarchy to see what is the root of patriarchy. So that the feminists then go to the caste and then they again stop over there. Okay? So they stop over there. They don't go into the Brahminism. They don't want to go there. And then because they know that if Brahminism is there, immediately Brahmin will be identified. The moment Brahmin is identified, the wife or the female counterpart of the Brahmin, Brahmini will be identified. So if logically or whichever way, it doesn't give them the legitimacy to kind of to kind of fight that, or they themselves are constrained in some manner. So they don't want to visit that area. They don't want to go there. We never had any limitations. I don't want to limit myself. I want to go, I want to consider myself first as a human being and then a woman. So all what is required and what is justified and what is needed for any human being, whether a man or a woman, is that I want for myself and my people and my women, everyone around me. So this feminism, and I also don't agree with the Dalit feminism thing. Again, what Dalit feminism is a chapter learned from the Brahminical feminism.
Yeah.
It's a chapter learned by, through them, and they taught the chapter to these women of Dalit feminism. What does it do? It says that within the Dalits also, or within Scheduled caste also, though they are Ambedkarites, they have patriarchy. But patriarchy essentially is a Brahminical origin.
Yeah.
Brahminism is a living force in this country. These people...
Patriarchy
are derived from it. Yeah, they are derived from it. And Brahminism and the Brahminical patriarchy is more difficult because it intertwines with caste and patriarchy.
Yes.
So it goes along with that. And it also goes because it is also is the religion also. So they don't want to talk on a religious plane. They do not want to talk it out on a ideological plane. No, no planes. Only positioning them at the level of the man, whether Dalit or whether Brahmin man. But what of the vichardhara? What is the thinking? What is the mind? They don't want to talk about it.
How do you see BAMSAF in the larger Bahujan movement? How do you see its interactions, associations with other Bahujan political parties or social organizations? How do, how much of give and take and interaction happens in both, and what are the common goals, if you think there are any?
The Brahminical world also influences our world of change, the way we see change. The struggle also is how much the struggle should be, where the struggle should be, to what point it should be, where it should start, where it should stop, is something which is again decided by the Brahmin discourse or the academicians or the sociologists or the activists who are from the upper varnas influencing our varnas. And that has been the reason why mostly what has been responsible for the so-called Dalit movement being cornered, so-called women movement, so-called Muslim movement, or any kind of a solution that these people were trying to see for themselves. So each and every component of the victimization that this Brahminical culture or Brahminical ideology, Brahminical world has in the, on the people of India, each and everyone is trying to find a way and means to fight against it, but holding on to its own camp or own identity, or a identity again given by the Brahminical. That being so, they have essentially minoritized themselves. Political democracy or change or social revolution or anything, or reducing the number of contradictions, will depend upon how much organic solidarity, organic unity these victimized groups have. How much, to what extent do they see, where exactly do they see their enemy, their opponent? If the opponent is being shown by the Brahminical society or culture in the immediate caste above you, then your energy and your fight is against the immediate caste above you or the immediate caste below you. And that is how Brahminism thrives. That is how Congress and BJP and all the other denominations of organizations and political parties have been able to rule. They purportedly on the political democracy side have been through the joint electorates or the something which was not given to us. The separate electoral system is not in place right now. So we have had people from these communities actually playing their politics according to their decisions, according to their planning and strategy in their Brahminical parties only. Yeah. This equation we want to change. We want to change this equation. And that is the reason why this, what we analyzed is, and we have come to the conclusion is, that the oppressor class, the ruling class, main strategy is to minoritize us. The more they minoritize us, the more effectively they can rule over us. The more effective contradictions they can create, in fighting they can create. That being so, Bahujan and Mulniwasi Bahujan. Mulniwasi Bahujan gives this cultural foundation, Bahujan numerical foundation. And we are here to tell our people that in a political democracy, or in a democracy for that matter, you are there to come together and fight together. That is one thing. This is a monumental change, because we have seen Dalit politics, Dalit literature, we have seen Muslim politics, women feminist. None of them.
We also seen Dravidian.
And scheduled tribes also, tribal people coming on their own. But there is something which binds them all. Yeah, the common, not only the victimization, the common culture binds them all. the common enemy binds them all, the value and ethics that they are fighting for. Eric Fromm, the philosopher, he says that you are fighting right now freedom for what exactly, you know? So these people are not, they don't know what are they fighting against, with whom are they fighting, and for what are they fighting. If they are fighting against the common enemy, if they know, then it's the common fight. If they are fighting for a non-Brahminical world or a Moolnivasi world based on equality, liberty and fraternity as it is enshrined in our constitution, if that is the, so they do not know what world they want to create. After all this struggle, do they want to still create a world in which the tribes will remain as tribes, or the Dalits will remain as Dalits or the various Jatis, and the OBCs will remain as Kunbi and Malhar and all the various Jatis? No, that is not what they are struggling for. Then why not come together in a common cultural identity? And Dr. Ambedkar, in the constitution already it is mentioned, social and educationally backward classes. So it was a unifying identity. What Dr. Ambedkar actually did was a very revolutionary thing. Before 1950, there were so many castes. In one stroke, Dr. Ambedkar kind of got all them together, 6,000 castes, into three different identifications. And it is a constitutional identification, SC, ST, OBC. So with this understanding, we are going and we are purporting. Secondly, how are we interacting with other organizations? BAMSIF's interaction has been very cordial, very friendly, and also very associative, you know, in a way. And BAMSIF has gained a lot of credibility among the Bahujan masses, among the Bahujan educated, the academicians, as well as people from various caste backgrounds. They know, they are aware that BAMSIF organization is working for the unity of all the Bahujan people together and for a common goal. Now, what is that, how does it interact, and what are the vantage points on which it is interacting? One is, essentially, you know, the entire struggle was whether, because we identify ourselves with the lineage and with the legacy, the stream of consciousness. Yes, I would call this as a stream of consciousness.
Yeah.
Of our being conscious as the original inhabitants of this country. So the moment we become conscious of being the originators of culture, the originators of labor, the originators of all the arts, all the modes of occupation, everything, you know, it's our people created that. The entire cosmos of practical knowledge. So the knowledge system is basically created by the Bahujans, the Moolnivasi Bahujans of this country. Today they may be known as the Muslims, they may be known as Sikhs, they may be known as Christians, because it was a socio-political necessity of that times that these very people had to escape the tyranny of the Brahminical system that they had to adopt.
Yes.
This is a reality which is mentioned in the text, in the everywhere. It's all-knowing reality. So this particular, this knowledge system, as it has, we have been the responsible, and we have created it, there has been a stream of consciousness which has denied all that is required for a human dignity and a progressive human race, evolving human race. So there's a force which has denied that. When we go to our people, whether they are working from the standpoint of an organization or a loose group or individuals or occupational groups. So when we as an organization approach them, we talk to them and we discuss and deliberate and have a dialogue with them as to the denial of what has been theirs and what has been denied. When Jyotirao Phule talks about education not as a means of living, but to understand the scheme and machinations of the Brahmin, you know. So, how the particular group has been a victim, from where the victimization occurs, their discrimination is at a different level. But yes, they are being discriminated. And they are being discriminated on two major points on which the modern progress depends. One is education, and second is their representation. Representation.
Yes.
If it's a democracy, a democracy is a form of a government. But people, if they have to be governed or they have to rule themselves, they have to adopt a way of being ruled over them by themselves. So that is the Ghana system or the democratic system. We've always adhered to it all the while.
Yes.
And if education has been denied, representation has been denied.
Yeah.
This is equally true whether you take the statistics and the data survey of Muslims in this country, you take of the Sikhs in this country, you take of the Christians, the Buddhists, or the SCST OBC. So how many people do you have? You have 90% people who are denied representation,
yeah,
and you have 90% people who are denied education, either through liberalization, globalization policy, or before 1915, it was through the diktats of the Brahminical text and how everything was formulated according to that. So this is how we reach our people.
For a common understanding. And also the actual harassment of Dalit students in universities, which is increasing in some areas, like in Hyderabad Central University recently. You were also involved with the struggle which evolved after the rustication of 5 Dalit students there in August 2015. Can you share your experiences and learning from it?
The whole thing started when, as I commented earlier, that the whatever is in vogue, whatever becomes the force, the Brahminical system is very deft enough to assimilate it into its own, or rather place themselves in position so that they can regulate it, they can control it, and they can actually channelize in a way that actually it eventually benefits them. So in HCU or in JNU or any of the institutes, central institutes, we know that there has been an over-representation of the minority people. 5-7% upper caste have been overrepresented.
Yes.
So 5% are occupying 70% of the faculty seats.
Yes.
The 5% people are occupying 80-90% of the student seats. And this of late has been little bit changing.
Yes.
And it changing in the sense that because of the constitution policy of education, and for the past 50 years, there has been a little bit of a...
because of reservation.
Let me tell you, I would say that in the constitution also, representation. It's a representation,
yes,
through reservation.
Yes.
Reservation is a policy or modality.
Yes.
But what is a right is a representation right. Okay? So, and that has to be in proportion to the population. So, there has been a little bit increase, not much actually, but that also is intolerable to the upper caste people over here, because they don't, if this particular class of people, they get educated, they will start questioning everything, each and everything, because how unscientific their religion is, how judiciary is being influenced, how media is influenced, how essentially all these structures are overrepresented by Brahmins and Baniyas and Kshatriyas. Students have started questioning, and Dr. Ambedkar of Jyotirao Phule were a product of this questioning spirit of inquiry only.
Yeah,
yeah? Kanshiram ji. Okay, all the modern Bahujan movement, it has been a product of that, and this has resulted, this kind of awakening had resulted in a whole class of people who will not look into their own gains, but work for the society. And, so fearing that, they started discriminating. Now, the discrimination in the universities is ubiquitous.
Yeah.
It takes form of various, either they are denied the subjects for a long time, they are made to feel that they are coming from a very economically weak background, or discriminating them on the basis of their caste identities in such a way that discouraging them totally, so as that they should leave those institute and go. If at all they are tenacious enough to stay back, then harassing them in such a severe way that abetting various kind of severe harassments. This is happening in each and every university in the country. If so far the leftist and the I generally call them I don't know what kind of comrades they are, for the past 20-25 years all these universities have been dominated by leftist movements and leftist organizations. They have never raised the issues of the Bahujans. They have never raised the issues of representation, or they have never ever talked, even if they have questioned the university or the state or the establishment, their issues have been very flimsy, whether mess related issues, or some food not being here, the windows not being barred, the grills not being on, this thing, the timing of the college messes closing at this time. And so these have been the issues. Whereas the real issues for the student, Bahujan students, are they coming from such backgrounds, and leaving almost an unearning house, unlooked for house way back in the village. They are coming here and spending the most part of their youth over here. And it is exactly when they should be looking to their progress and going up in life to the next stage in life, to be of use to their family and the society, this is exactly where they are being suppressed. So looking into this, it was very natural. And so naturally, the Bahujan students in the leftist organization, they felt disenchanted totally. And it is rightly so. It was high time. They started organizing themselves. Not only did they start organizing, they started questioning the state, the establishment, and they started questioning the state and establishment on Phule Ambedkarite ideology. That has been the problem with them. If they had been questioning them on the basis of Marxist ideology or Leninist ideology, they never had a problem, because for the leftist, it is good as long as the discussion is only on class. Because upper class, lower class, rich, poor, this is the paradigm and this is the discourse that they want to keep alive. They don't want to bring the discourse down to the origin, that the root of all problems in this country is Brahminism, is casteism. And unless you uproot, Dr. Ambedkar very clearly said, uproot Brahminism. He quoted this as a prerequisite for the working of democracy. And the higher educational institutes are the domain in which these people will be the next torchbearers of this country. That is exactly where they want to harm. That is exactly the point where they want to harm. So the HCU administration, covered up by the Ministry of Human Resources, MRD, and the Ms. Smriti Irani, Mr. Bandaru Dattatreya over here, and the BJP government, the RSS control on the BJP government, they all worked in connivation to each other. They were hand in glove. They knew exactly what they were doing. For them, on one hand, they make a sham effort of celebrating Dr. Ambedkar's birth anniversary, or making a huge show and pomp and show out of it. If they really want to, we don't expect that they will, neither there we have any, glamorous visions and unrealistic visions of this upper caste people to do that. But then they could easily implement in the syllabus annihilation of caste. They should do that. They should, if Dr. Ambedkar's vision and philosophy has to be established, it is not through celebrating his birthdays over there.
Yeah.
He never wanted it that way. Hero worship and personality cultism is something which he detested. Any true Democrat will detest. So, keeping that sham on the other side, this is, they did not want that the true revolutionary spirit or pedagogy of Dr. Ambedkar, Phule, Periyar they don't want it to. They want to discuss Raja Ram Mohan Roy, they want to discuss Vivekananda, they want to discuss Dhyanand Saraswati, or they want to discuss Marx, whose relevance they themselves are not able to explain to the students over here. They themselves are not able to explain it to students over here. So they do not want a true revolution to happen. They do not want Samajik Parivartan. They don't want any change. They don't want evolution. So this equation again has to be changed. And this is what Ambedkar Student Association was trying to do. This is what Moolniwasi Sangh is trying to do. Moolniwasi Vidyarthi Sangh is trying to do in various universities when we are establishing units. And it is from here that Rohit was targeted. Yeah. It was targeted, and they bring it to such a level, you know, mental harassment to such a level that at certain point in time, one is not left with choosing any other option because one is so mentally and in each and every way discouraged, harassed, and it's a kind of a tormented, a torture. It's a torture of the third degree, basically, that these people, the Bahujan students, have to suffer. Interestingly, what is to be seen is that we took out, when we were working in this particular incident and Rohit, we were there from the time, on the 10th of January, when it was they were suspended. We had a round table in HCU University campus only. And then 17th, of course, when Rohit committed suicide, or rather he was made to commit suicide, we were there. And when we saw the last 10 years record of HCU and the records of major universities in the country, we have seen that all the students who committed suicide were Bahujan students. They were SC, ST, OBC. Means overrepresentation is by the Brahmins and the upper caste. And the ones who are dying and committing suicide are the Bahujans. Despite this, the acquittal rate is very high. And whether it was Senthil or Venkat Giri and many more students from
Madari Venkat.
Madari Venkat.
Pulliyara Raju.
Yeah, Pulliyara Raju. All these students, it is so funny, it's so weird that the entire department, the court says, it doesn't point about on one single person. Means in their judgment also, they want to acquit these people. They want to release these people.
Yeah.
Who? The Brahminical faculty.
Yeah.
They are notorious. They are notorious, and it has become the norm in the universities. It has become an acceptable pattern and behavior. This pattern has been internalized by the Bahujan students also. They know very well that it will be 6 months before they are given a topic. Before the proposal comes, before the synopsis is accepted, that for many, many months they will be on the bench doing nothing. This is a norm over there. So how long should it go on?
Saffronization is also increasing across the universities. Even cultural rules are being imposed. RSS shakas are being opened in central universities. So what course should future student struggles take, ways in which Bahujan students can help themselves?
See, we immediately, actually the thing is, this particular problem has to be brought out of the universities into the masses and into the society, and it has to be a joint struggle. Because unless that kind of pressure is there on the universities and the various ministries, you know, this will go on. Second is to have a proper act. So Rohit Act, if it is to be brought into place, that is something that the students and the youth outside the universities have to strive for. That is, though I do agree, and we really know that we can have many laws, but then the implementer of laws and the work, those who are going to work upon it, whether they are SST Atrocity Act or Nirbhaya Act or this particular Rohit Act, it all depends upon the people who are going to
implement
it. Nevertheless, but this would be a very positive, it will be a direct incrimination of these people. And this will go into the annals of history of India, that such a Rohit was there, that such a thing was happened, that 10 students have died, 100 students have died because of a Brahminical terrorism in the universities. There's a Brahminical terrorism. Shakas and Brahminical culturalization and Brahminization, these people have been the modus operandi, those have been the nodal operators, who the faculty.
Yeah.
The over representation of the faculty is in itself the Brahminization of the universities.
Central universities.
Central universities.
98%
faculty. Faculty are there. So that has to be questioned.
We were all the time focusing on the VC and Apra and Mandaru Dattatreya and Smriti Irani. But why did no one question the over representation of this faculty? Of the Brahmin Savarna in the faculty and in administrative position, 98%, which is the reality not just in HU but also in JNU,
yes.
In Delhi University,
yes.
Banaras Hindu University,
yes.
All the IITs, all the NITs. But no one questioned the root of the problem, that the Brahmin Savarna is overrepresented there and nobody else's voice will be heard.
Exactly.
How did this, Bahujan struggle over there not raise this voice?
One major reason for this has been, there has been a thin voice. We have been, at least from Munyadi Sangh Bamsev and the other organizations which have been working, we have very often raised this particular thing of representation. But what I feel is that, Brahminism has got a very deft kind of I hold responsible in totality. The leftist in the and leftist Brahmins. For responsible for this.
Yeah.
And the Bahujan students who are actually aligning themselves with the leftist ideology, because the leftist or the communist ideology in India has been totally Brahminized. It has undergone a total change so much so that it is non-recognizable. I cannot recognize and keep it aside with all due respect and to Marx and all the proponents of communism, in the sense they are very much there. We totally respect them, but the Indian Marxism has been totally Brahminized, or it has been. So these faculty, they will be questioning. So if questioning is there, they say we will solve it, and we will solve it through a leftist way. We will solve it through the leftist way, and that leftist way is one which doesn't recognize caste. It doesn't recognize Brahminism.
It doesn't recognize over-representation of a small minority
in the district. So they have had a gala time altogether. They have had a roaring good time, actually. So, and these people, all my students, all our students, my people, my students, our Bahujan students, they have always been misled, intoxicated by telling that class operates, caste doesn't mean, or questioning caste, which actually make them being casteist, all these ingrained, brainwashing which has been done, this has happened. So more than BJP, RSS and Shakhas, it is the leftist cadre camps which have led to all this. This has been largely responsible. Students who have educated from the universities and have taken up jobs, they themselves have been called bourgeois.
Yeah.
Now, how can anybody become bourgeois by getting educated?
Yeah.
They have mixed up, they have totally distorted, they have done it purposely. It's not that the Brahmin doesn't know what he is doing.
Yeah.
He very well knows.
He does it with a purpose.
He does it with a purpose. And the Bahujans have been naive and very gullible enough to set aside Ambedkar, to set aside what Dr. Ambedkar has said about Indian communism, and they should not put their intelligence into such kind of prostitution which doesn't allow to a critique of communism in India by any of them, not only Dr. Ambedkar, or take anybody of them, take Peria,
yes.
take Babu Jagdev Prasad, take anybody, but why are they not allowing any criticism of Indian communism over here? Precisely because then the dialogue will come to caste, then the discourse will come to caste, and that one is one blind alley for them. They do not want to go into that lane, because that lane is from where our Bahujan people will be able to liberate themselves.
A student in a very prominent central university, an elite educational institution, committing suicide. It's an atrocity happening right in a city, metropolitan city, in the middle of the day. And we, how does it compare with the atrocities in the villages? It's the same kind of...
Exactly. The governing class, whether Congress, BJP, RSS, Aam Aadmi Party, or this particular leftist, close camaraderie, they have always have had their planning and strategy very much in place.
Yeah.
And at each one very critical point, they have gone on to eat 10, 15, 20 years of our movement.
Yeah.
How? For about as soon as the constitution came into being, I said came into being, it is not being implemented. It is still not being implemented.
Yeah.
So there is no question that the constitution is implemented. But as soon as it came into being, the SCs were told, even if the Kaka Kalanikar Commission was there, there was an activity which had begun, not letting it get into place until almost 90s, late 80s. For almost 30-40 years, SCs and OBCs were made to fight each other, telling the OBCs that the scheduled castes are taking up all your share. Okay, those 10-20 years went like that, and the communists were hand in glove. They did that. They said the same thing what the BJP and the Congress did. I have seen Mr. Yerchuri talking against representation through reservation. He has talked against education.
He was always talking.
Not only that, any higher, either they have been silent or they have been talking against. So this particular over-representation, as you said, it was never questioned. It was never questioned from the high echelons of the community. And that has been responsible. Now,
the over-representation in the judiciary also.
The atrocity which you say, so the 10 year, next 10 years, they kept on talking about merit. We know that the merit thing fell flat on its face. But till the time that it fell flat on its face, Bahujan Samaj 20 years again went off. Why? Being in the defensive and trying to explain to them that no, we are meritorious.
Yeah.
Why should we do that? But then we are forced to do that. We are forced to justify ourselves, and we are made to go so much into our own inferiority complexes, thanks to the dialogical and the dialectics that we use. So that is then recently, ever since OBCs, through whatever little percentage, despite implying the creamy layer and everything, how they want to engage us into something else, that no, there is class, there is no caste. So these are the tactics.
So we still have the same, some old challenges and then some new challenges before the Bahujan, Samaj. We have had the last, after Baba Sahib, Kanchiram Sahib and others will also come up. So we still have many more challenges and some old challenges, as I keep repeating, still there. How do you plan to, how does BAMSEF and plan to face these challenges?
The main challenge which is there is that each and every institution of this country, whether it is the syllabus, whether the education, whether judiciary, whether media, it is the over-represented, 100% near total representation of the upper caste is the main problem of this country. These people, the Bahujans, the 97-95% population of this country, or 90-95% population, they have to get a hold on these institutions based on their ethical system, ethical values. This is a major challenge. Because the judiciary, that is the place where the interpretation of the constitution will be there. But we have seen through so many cases, right from Indira Sahni to practically to the Doraiswamy case, Dorairajan case, and the creamy layer of which was
Ashok Thakur.
All these cases and other, they have consistently tried to fight and deny representation to the Mulvasi Bahujans. Forget about the private sector. There is no question of representation in the private. Why should we ask for private sector reservations? We should. I say that is my birthright. That is the Mulvasi Bahujans' birthright. This is our country. So when we talk, as you were asking me about how we are coordinating with the other organizations, so the Mulvasi Bahujan Samaj challenge, this big challenge, we are trying to counter it with the help of all these people asking for their or fighting for their get representation in these institutions of power. Yeah, that is a major challenge. Second major challenge is the propaganda, the system of propaganda in this country. It is totally Brahminized, and the over-representation of Brahmins in the media is another big challenge that the whole Bahujan Samaj is facing. The
judiciary is another
bad. Yeah, judiciary is just, yeah, I just did tell about judiciary.
Because atrocities cases, it is mostly the judiciary which is, encouraging people to not follow the law.
Yeah,
many ways.
Yeah, and see, Kufirji, atrocities will happen if that particular community is weak. If it is educationally weak, if it is economically weak, if it has no ways of redressal to its issues. So, as you said, in the universities,
or if the other community has more power,
exactly,
excessive representation.
So, as you said, that the university atrocities of also the same as the atrocity which is happening in the village.
Yes.
So, you have the entire, whether the Mulvasi Bahujan Samaj is highly educated or not, or in the villages, the level of atrocities is the same. And what is that to deny? To deny this denial of opportunity. That is the major level of fight that we have to. Second challenge is that the Bahujan Samajas, culturally, it is not that their culture that they are following, whether in festivals, whether in their folklore, in their observances. And this has resulted in subjugation of the women folk, totally women. It has resulted in the entire new generation, being raised up till the level of graduation or post-graduation into the same scheme of things, because the whole syllabus, Indian syllabus of all the schools and colleges is totally Brahminized. So they have not developed an alternate discourse or a questioning or argumentative spirit at all to question. This is mass extermination agenda.
Okay.
Denying, and then segregating. Third challenge is the Mulvasi Bahujan Samaj being segregated in jati or in caste. This is done by highlighting the jati identities on media, in popular magazines, in culture, in literature, in usages. Reward by the tactics of reward and punishment. Okay, so in the villages they will be punished if they are not working according to the norms of the jati. Yeah. So all this is, and the fourth is the Bahujan Samaj is that a large portion of their economy and of their earning is going into the temples. The temples are the major area of concentration of power and concentration of money. Forget about the power. The power will go if the money out of that goes. And these are the challenges of the Bahujan Samaj I spoke to you. Then what about the Bahujan movement? The Bahujan movement, I feel, is facing two main challenges. One is that it is come to the point of level that the Bahujan Samaj is going on identifying itself as a Bahujan. Now we do not have so much of difficulty. Earlier, each and every person was either identifying himself Dalit or something, and caste organizations and caste committee meetings and whatnot. But now they are identifying themselves as Bahujans. Still, what are the what are the processes which still remain as an obstacle for the process of nation building, for the process of our freedom struggle from the Brahmins? They are the Y section of the entire Bahujan Samaj in various identities, one. And second is the individual leadership pattern or the hero worship oriented pattern. This particularly is a Brahminical construct. Avatarvad, one savior, one Krishna, one Modi,
one Masiha.
That one Masiha is a nemesis for Bahujan Samaj. And that still we haven't come over. You know, whether TRS comes into power, whether
Anna DMK
or whether this kind of worshipping an Avatarvad or Congress or whatever, these people, unless and until they realize that it's the collective leadership, is the organic collective consciousness. If the consciousness is collective, then the leadership has to be collective. Then it can't be. And then it has to be, leadership also has to be representative.
We have to also think of an alternative political formation.
Exactly.
Following this
and alternative has to work for us. Because our, the cultural capital, if it is rich, our organizational capital is poor. Because the Brahmins and the RSS are the most organized people from gaining the experience for the past so many thousand years. So, what our strategies have to be different from those defined by them for us. We cannot play on to Brahminical strategies, their strategies, and say that the Bahujans will be liberated through these ways and means. No, not at all. So, the collective leadership developing, democratic functioning, what we call non-individualistic, non-propping of an individual savior, these are the things which will deliver.
Thank you, Dr. Manisha Bangar, for joining us and sharing your views on various subjects. Wish you all success in taking forward your contribution to the Bahujan movement. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Jai Bhim.